يبقى اقدم من السجن. Does this thing work? Then share it with the rest of us. And so that's what I'm asking you to do, to share it. I tell you it works. We have found that which the whole vast world has been seeking, and it works. But you will not know it by just hearing about it. To be convinced, you must test it and prove it, and you can prove it. Now we turn to the great book, the Bible, and you be the judge to what extent you've accepted the testimony of Jesus. For we repeat here night after night that it's very important that we hear the testimony of Jesus and respond to it. So when I make the claim here, quoting Blake, that all that you behold, though it appears without, it is within, in your imagination, of which this world of mortality is but a shadow. And I mean that literally. This is not just a lovely poetical thought that was expressed by Blake. He meant it literally. And so the Bible makes the statement, you read it in the sixth chapter of the book of John. It's really called the chapter of secession. Because in this chapter, Paul claim is repeated throughout the chapter. And at the very end, they seceded. And the statement that caused it was this, no one can come unto me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And I will raise him up at the last day. And then we are told, he asks a very simple question, and suppose you saw the Son of Man ascending into heaven. There was no response. No one believed it. And then he said, that's why I tell you that no one can come to me unless it be granted him by the Father. No one. And then he says, now the evangelist writing the story is now allegorizing. And so it's said, and Jesus knew from the first who those were who did not believe and who it was that should betray him. Knew from the first who did not believe and who should betray him. Now we read the story carefully, and he said, he repeats it again. No one can come unto me unless the Father who sent me draws him. Then we are told that many at this point, many of the disciples turned back, never to walk with them again. Never to go with them again. Well, who are the disciples who turned back? They couldn't go all the way. They came away, but they couldn't go all the way. Now, who then judges you? For the drama is taking place in us. We hear the testimony. We hear it on a platform, or we read it in the book, or maybe we have the experience. But to what extent can we go all the way? We are told that there's a law, the law of the identical harvest. That be not deceived, God is not mocked. For as a man sows, so shall he reap. And then we are told, and the Lord said, let me earth put forth vegetation, plants bearing seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. No variation, each according to its kind. Now I think the whole vast world will accept that in the vegetable world. And they will come into the animal world and accept it. That cows produce cows, and men produce, men and women produce, well, men and women. And so we can take that law in the natural world and see that it does work. Can we step beyond that boundary and take it out in the mental world? Can we now actually perform a mental act, an imaginal act, and observe the working of it, and then admit when we see the fruit that the imaginal act of the seed planted by us and the thing that we see reflecting it is really the offspring of the fruit of it? Can we accept it? Well, I trust that everyone here will accept that. I think the majority of you will. And that's why you are here. But can you go further? And say, no man, now there's nobody now, no man can come to me unless the Father who sent me brought them. could not believe for one moment that encountering a total stranger in the world, and that stranger comes and plays a part in my life, that he cannot come unless my Father draws him. And I and my Father are one. I am in the Father, and the Father in me. So that no one comes into my life and plays any part in my life that I am drawing him. Good, bad, or indifferent. He just can't come. Well, man isn't big enough as yet to accept that widening circle. Can't quite stretch up that far to encompass the whole vast world, and that everything that is happening in his individual life, he's the cause of it. He can't quite relate these events, when they are touched by living beings in the world, to anything that he inwardly has ever done. He can't relate it one moment. But I say, you be the judge. Whether you believe it or not. For example, I know everyone from the very first. Why did he know everyone from the very first? Well, who is he that knew all this? Are we not told? What person knows a man's thoughts? Except the spirit of the man which is in him. No man knows a man's thoughts except the spirit of the man which is in him. But who is the spirit in you? I tell you, it is Jesus Christ. I have been crucified with Christ. It is not I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Read it in the second chapter, the 20th verse of Galatians. I have actually been crucified with them. And it is not I who live, but Christ who lives in me. For the Spirit in me knows, he knew from the beginning whether I believe it or not. So that I sit here this night, do I believe it? To what extent will I believe this law of liberty? Whether not a thing is happening that I didn't cause, not a thing in my world. Well, who betrayed me now? I knew the one who had betrayed me. But no one can betray me unless he has my secret. But no one. You can't betray a man unless you know the man's secret. And to know the man's secret, you'd have to be the spirit of that man. So who could betray a man but himself? So no man takes away my life. I lay down myself. The power to lift it up and the power to lay it down again. So no man takes away my life. So he knew the one who would betray and should betray him, because he is himself. He is self-betrayed. He knows the secret to the point where everything is happening in this world because he is the sole cause of all the things that he encounters, that experiences, that is the one cause. He knows it. And so he betrayed the creator spirit within himself. He knows what is the cause of it. He's found it in himself. His own wonderful human humanity is the Christ spirit in him that really is the cause of the phenomenon of his life. He knows that. And so now he's self-betrayed. He will share it with the world, but who will accept it? He will tell it to the world, and so they will themselves judge to what extent they will go with him. But when he comes to the statement that no man can come unto me, except the Father who sent me draws him, we draw the line there. Now let me share with you what has been given to me. The gentleman is here tonight, and this is his story, has given me last. The scenes were all right individually. But for some reason or other, I just wasn't satisfied with the story. So Sunday morning, realizing that the story was the problem, and not my treatment of the story, I did this. I put myself into the shoes of Robert Louis Stevenson. And then I imagine how he must have felt after he had written a good story. Then I went back and put on my own shoes and tried to match that feeling which I had imagined to be Stevenson's feeling as he felt having produced a good story. Now, technique that he employed. All this happened while I was taking my morning walk. When I came home, I began to list point by point to my wife what I thought was wrong with the story. And then, point by point, I saw someone standing behind me and prompting me. And suddenly, the solution to each point came into my mind. Just as if someone was standing behind me and prompting me. And the whole thing came into my mind, point by point. Now he said, I should add that while I was gone, my wife had imagined wonderful things are happening. Wonderful things are happening. Wonderful things are happening. So I'm not sure that your wife would understand. But when a man is at home day in and day out, a woman has to use generalizations, sweeping generalizations. So she would understand that because my wife and I spend the 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. We're all in the same place. And so he, the writer, uses his home as I use my home. So, with that confession off, he said about an hour later, I was in the shower. And I was presently recalling an experience of 6 years ago. Recalling this thing that happened 6 years ago. When a story was being, or it seemed to be, dictated to me in a like manner. The thing that just happened, as someone standing behind me and dictating the story of this past hour, and it seemed 6 years ago, as I recall the story, that this happened in a like manner. Some presence dictated or seemed to have dictated the story. And then it hit me like a sledgehammer. For the story of 6 years ago was this, that central character in the story of 6 years ago was Eddie. Identical, done to a T. It was Eddie. And then, if you were here when we told the story of Eddie, let me now tell you the character that he conceived 6 years ago. He said he was mildly insane. Well, you know, Eddie was committed to an insane asylum for those who were mildly insane. He said the character was periodically picked up and released by the police. Well, the police picked up Eddie and read a book. A child wouldn't take him back. The police didn't want him, and so the police released him. He said, for plot reasons, I gave the character a limp in the right foot, the right leg. So had Eddie a limp in the right leg. He said, the people of the town, of the character, treated him in the way that the people in my neighborhood treat Eddie. The character lived in a tent outside the town. Eddie lives today in a tent up in the hills of Hollywood. The character wore the kind of clothes, the same clothing that Eddie wears. The character had a fascination with atomic fallout. In fact, he perpetrated a hoax upon the town and almost scared the daylights out of them and they wanted to lynch him. Eddie has the most unusual fascination for atomic fallout and tells me he has a pipe. But when he rubs it with some other piece of metal, he can cause atmospheric disturbance on any part of the earth. And it disturbs him because he feels his misuse of this pipe, which he calls his space needle, is the cause of the unrest in parts of the world, like Cyprus, for instance. So he's got to restrain himself. He has probably buried this pipe on the desert, which, said the writer, is perhaps safer than where he usually keeps it under my house. And so, the same intense interest, when he said, this is the amazing similarity between these two, that the feeling I have always had for the character is identical to the feeling I have for Eddie. Now, he said, I didn't tell this story to my wife immediately. I wanted to test it. And so I began to tell her and describe to her a story of a character. And I purposely omitted the limp in the right leg, because had I said it, she would instantly have thought of Eddie. So I didn't mention that characterization. Then I omitted completely from my vocabulary the use of the words unwanted and rejected, which, by the way, in describing this character, he felt himself unwanted and rejected. But in spite of these omissions, she said to me, "You were talking about Eddie." And then, said he, "I was stunned that my wife, on a description of a character I conceived 6 years ago, could see in that character and not see that character. But I'm talking only of one character she noticed, Eddie. So I really should sign this letter worried. For the simple reason, having written all my life, I have created some characters that I'm in no hurry to meet in the flesh." So, everyone has done that. Then he goes on, and of course, I quickly turn to your book, The Law of the Promise, and reread the chapter. There is no fiction. And now, said he, with this off my chest, as it were, I must say something good in favor of an outside God and candles. For in my present state of mind, I think that really such a thing, an outside God, would be more comforting than to be the God creating all these things that's coming into my world. But I reflect upon the characters as a writer I have conceived and projected on the screen, characters I don't really want to meet in a hurry, not in the flesh. Then he said, "I hope you'll keep this letter in a safe place. Because if I ever want proof or insanity, I will have it. You keep it in a safe place, and the way I need it to prove my insanity, well, there is the proof. For here, this one, this gentleman, has gone all the way, and is willing now, from his confession in this letter, to admit that the character Eddie, that seemingly came by accident after great rainstorms, that all the clouds were rushed in the neighborhood, and Eddie had no job for the day, and coming his way up the hill, up into where he lives in his tent, this gentleman very kindly gave him a lift, and the friendship began there. Because outside of this friendship, which he says is the same intense feeling he has for him that he had for his character, and he always had for the character, we have no social meeting point. We do not travel in the same social circle, intellectual circle, financial circle. Yet, there is a closer feeling, I'm quite sure, towards this baby than he has towards maybe 9/10 of those who move in his circles. And he created any. So I said that everyone, you may not recognize the character. Maybe you're not a writer. And have written to the point where you can remember an actual character that you created out of the nowhere. And have it produced, and saw the production yourself, and moved out to see the character that he remembered. And then he ran into the flesh and blood character that he conceived 6 years before. So the sixth chapter of the book of John. No one can come unto me unless the Father who has sent me draws him. The last day, I will lift him up. I'll raise him up at the last day. I'll tell this gentleman exactly how he's going to raise him up. The day will come, and the last day doesn't mean the last day of 24 hours. It means the last day of the journey from the cradle to the grave, but it is your last time around. And you're not on the wheel of the cars anymore. And when that last phase comes to an individual, he will have this experience. When you least expect it, no one ever told him about it, and maybe what I tell you now, you'll forget and quickly forget. So when it happens, it will come as a very wonderful pleasant surprise, because you have no memory that you heard it from my lips. But what? You don't know about it, you never read about it, no one told you about it, and one night, or they come through the day, but in my case, it always seems to come, and we hours of the morning. And so, you would be suddenly twisted from within yourself, like a corkscrew, and through your skull you will go. And you will be clothed in the most glorious body of fire and air. It's self-luminous. You need no stars, no sun, no moon to illuminate your path. And a heavenly chorus will call your name, whatever your name is. And they will pronounce the name and say, he is risen. Not he is risen, but the name. Say your name is John. John is risen. John is risen. They'll repeat it. And then this chorus will sing out, the most glorious heavenly chorus will sing, your praise because you have been risen. And then you will come upon a sea of infinite imperfection, human imperfection. The limp of any will be there. The blind, the heart, the river, everything you've conceived are taking human form. And they're waiting for you, their Redeemer, to redeem them. And as you glide by, you seem to glide by, they meanwhile will be transformed into the image of perfection. You do not raise a finger to make it so. Blind people become those of perfect sight. The gap here, the limp, the heart, the river, all cease to be what they were as you pass by. And when you come to the very end, and the last one is finished, and all are perfect, then the same heavenly chorus will exult and ring out, it is finished, the last cry on the cross. And then you, for unfinished business, will return here to complete it, to turn it, maybe to leave it in a more permanent form, in the form of a picture or a story, but you will tell it in a more permanent form that you yourself have none of experience, because that's forever as far as you are concerned, but you will tell it for the benefit of others and scream it out as it were. Return here to complete the few remaining years, for your end is ahead. Everyone had to be raised that you were created. Everyone had to be transformed into perfection to conform to you that you were lifted up at that very moment you were perfect. And so as you walked by, you molded them in harmony with the perfection springing within you. And you do it without effort, without taking thought. You are above the conceptual mind. You're not concerned about these people. You simply work by knowing in the depth of your soul it is all perfect, and everyone is reshaped and molded in harmony with that perfection springing within you. So you're told, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will lift all men unto me. I will shape them and transform them. And so no man came, save I called them. If I call any, they will live. And then memory said, be well. I'm taking a shower. And suddenly I'm presently recalling a story of 6 years ago. And when I recall it and develop it, suddenly it dawns upon me. Well, I've been walking around this past 2 years in the company of one that I myself have created and I didn't recognize. Here is a man in my own bio. And for 2 years he's been in my life. I've been an intimate of my world. And I didn't recognize my own creation. Well, that's what the world does all day long. It draws only its own, but doesn't recognize its own creation. No man cometh unto me save I call him. For my Father and I alone. So if he can't come unless my Father draws him, he can't come unless I draw him. For I and my Father are one. And so I'm drawing every being into my world, good, bad, or indifferent. So when I think he is not, and he crosses my path morning, noon, and night, he is no good, you can't trust him. Where in my world can I go back to that moment of mistrust in me, when I really couldn't trust myself? I couldn't. I was afraid of my own behavior if given an opportunity. If I thought I would get away with it, I might. I need not be able to sit down and write the story. I could enact the story. I could walk through a storm. And if no one really had eyes upon me, and I thought they didn't, I might contemplate with pleasure an act that, if caught, would be quite embarrassing to those who love me. I might. If in the fact I ever contemplated that someone's going to cross my path and come right into my world, I would play that right in my world. so once, many years ago, near the very intimate story, and I told it certainly not to build any hatred here, but to encourage every person in this world to forgive everything in this world, because you're the cause of the behavior of everyone you're observing in this world. And I told it in a most intimate manner because it struck home forcibly. And I was severely criticized by the audience for it, and criticized the following month by the wife of the gentleman who brought me to this town to give a series of lectures. And she said, well, I thought that was very, very unbecoming. And so many have criticized you for it. They've written me letters. I can tell you of many of them are letters I received that are very, very critical of what you said from the platform. I said, I didn't say for any purpose other than to show everyone that they are the cause of the misbehaviors of others that they condemn. They are the cause of it. And so I tried to explain to her that it was not condemnation of the person. I was putting myself, I was the cause of her arrest, the cause of her action. And this is the story. I was married and separated for 15 years. No divorce and no final separation, no legal separation, but separated. I was married at the age of 18, father at 19, separated at 20. And then for the next 15 years, we lived our separate lives and only saw each other when she tried me to court for non-payment of alimony. That's the only time we ever saw each other. I always came out of the court with a reduction. Always, one after the other. So, 7 times before the judge and 7 times they went down this way. And finally she knew that without taking any more, there's nothing else to get. You get nothing the next time. And so that was the picture. So I told her, so all these things are happening. And one day I knew I wanted to get married to a certain party, who is now the mother of my daughter. But I had all this entangled personal life. Not separated legally. You can't get divorced in New York City, except on one grounds, the most archaic law in the world. Therefore, nothing but collusion goes on in the courts, divorce courts in New York City. So I was not being enforced upon man because of this archaic law. Well, I wanted my divorce. And then she was told by a very close, intimate friend of mine that I wanted a divorce and to really leave town, get out of town. But my friend didn't want me to get a divorce and marry the girl that I eventually married. So, I go, all right, I will now apply this law, and I stepped as though I were happily married to the girl who now bears my name. And at the end of a week, my dancing partner, who I thought was the one who had been told to fly, and she was, came to me and told me that she only for me as a brother. Just a brother. She could never marry me because there was not that feeling towards me. But that made me very happy. And then, the other one was gone now. Never to be funded again. So, the world would think. But I still stepped in the assumption that I was happily married. And one morning, the phone rang. As I answered the phone, it's the courtroom calling. This is the federal building. I said, yes. Are you deaf or daughter? Yes. Are you the public speaking post by the name of Neville? I said, yes. Well, now you've got to be in court next Tuesday morning at 10. Well, I was too sleepy to ask why. And so, next Tuesday morning, just a little before 10, here, the phone rings again. Are you deaf or daughter? I said, yes. And why aren't you in court? Didn't we call you last Tuesday to tell you to be in court today? I said, why should I be in court? What's wrong that I should be in court? I have been subpoenaed. Then said, Miss Party of the Lawyer, you're a public character, and the reporters are all of us in court, and I'd love to get this bit of story into the papers, and the papers today. Well, I said, well, what's wrong? They said, well, your wife happens to be on trial, and so if you would come on down, and maybe you could throw some light upon this. So I went on down. Got into the courtroom just in time to see them bring up into the dock, as it were. Three judges came in, took their position, and then someone whispered to one judge, and then the voice said, is Mr. Garland in the courtroom? I said, I'm here. Would you take the stand? You're not swearing, not under oath, but maybe he could help us before he was back here. And so I took the stand. And they asked me if you're of the same religious faith. They said, no, she was born a Catholic, I was born a Protestant. But that's no problem. She is not a practicing Catholic, and I'm not a practicing Protestant. So it's not problem at all. And then he said, well, then, could you throw some light at her? First of all, she's 8 years my senior. And you know my age, that we must know her age. She's undoubtedly passing through some emotional disturbance. And so when a woman is passing through some stress, well, they can do any irrational thing. What she's now charged with, I am quite sure she's never done it before. Even if you have the evidence to support it, I still say she's never done it before. I will swear she'll never do it again. I ask you, for my son's sake, who lived with me, that if you've got to sentence her, that for the Lord's sake, sentence her, but then be merciful and suspend it. He said, I've never heard a plea in this court of mine similar to that in all my years on the bench. For the man who has nothing to gain by this merciful plea of his, when he really wants a divorce because we have all the problems before us, taken from your wife when she was in jail for this past week, waiting for this dead trial. He said, I'll act upon your recommendation, Mr. Garner. I've offended you for 6 months and suspected that you'd better come before me again. Mary met me in the lobby. He said, that was a very decent thing of you to do, Devil. Give me the papers. I said, I don't have any papers with me. Come, how would I give them to you? We wrote it together. First time in these many, many years, we have a closer than between the judge and the bench. We wrote together to my hotel, and I gave her the papers. I have not been able to serve for a number of months. Here were the papers. And we got my divorce uncontested. So I told that story to say that I caused her to do what she did. And I not assumed that I was free to marry the girl that now bears my name. She would never have done these things at all. And so she goes into a store, and the first coming of her, she picks up something that she hadn't paid for. And someone saw it. I'm sorry, it was a silly thing. But nevertheless, she did it. And that's what brought her into the city, that I could find her. And she was moved to ask me to give her the papers because I freed it for her. And so having done all this, who actually was the culprit? I was the culprit. She came right into my will to pray a certain God, to grant me my freedom. I'm speaking of the law of liberty. And so, should she be condemned to an act by the unseen author of Paul? I didn't write it out. I said, I'm writing it by Paul. But I determined the behavior of that body that she had to do something in order to not have to take the papers from me. And so, I tell the only to show that don't condemn anyone. You and you alone are the author of the things happening in your life. And therefore, when you condemn a man, this gentleman, right into his grip, a limp in the right leg. Here comes a man with a limp in the right leg. He writes everything into an imaginary character than he is an imaginary at all. You can't distinguish between what the world calls the imaginary and reality. You can't. This is all wrong. And so people could not go beyond a certain limit. And so you could say, well, I will assume that I am what I want to be. And things happen in my world like this. But don't tell me now that I've actually created her in that character I did. And so many departed never to work with him again. Never. And so he turns now to the 12 who remain. He said, would you go also? And Peter answered, to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we believe and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Now, to whom is Peter speaking? He isn't speaking to another. Whoever is the character written in this drama as Peter came to that decision within himself. It's the most difficult thing in the world to accept. For this is the cause of cessation. They're seceding at that moment because they will not accept the fact that they are actually the cause of these things that are living and moving in their world. Some people, some limited, some main, and they are the cause of it. They will not accept it, you know, all right? They left him, never to work with him again. And then Peter said, to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life. These are true. And now to whom will I turn? For you know we have believed, and we have come to know you are the Holy One of God. No, not, but turn back now to Matthew, and you see the answer. Who do people say that I am? Some say John the Baptist. Some say Elijah come again. Some say Jeremiah. And some say a prophet of old. Doesn't respond to that. He asks another question. But whom do you say that I am? And Peter becomes a spokesman. And Peter answers, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not told you this, but my Father who is in heaven has revealed it to you. Who is the Father in heaven? He said, I am the Father. And you see the Father. So who but the Spirit in man is revealing? What Christ really is. No God can come again. No reincarnation. But man has Christ within him. And he's awakening. More than I know. So the gentleman wrote the story concerning Eddie. That you know, up until now, I really wanted to wake up. And then try to wake up. But now, I'm trying definitely to go to sleep again. Oh, but he doesn't want, but he really doesn't need it. He doesn't want what he's just discovered. This enormous responsibility to be responsible for the type that he has created. And to all work in the end, and one after the other would enter his circle and become an intimate, and one that he really is very fond of. One that he created, and endowed with all these strange things, a peculiar mental unbalance, and a limp in his right leg, and unwanted by society, and looked down on by the neighborhood, put him in a pit, and ostracized him from society, and make him unwanted and unwashed, and, well, repellent in many ways. And all these things he does to a character, and falls in love with the character. So you can see the words, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. They're playing all these parts because they're magnificent men and women are writing dramas. And the world is forever falling under the spell of the magnificent men and women. No matter what the world will tell you, the world is falling under the spell of those who are awake, who are writing intensely with emotion. So today, you try it. I hope, but the judgment is yours, don't tell me, but I hope you can go all the way. And don't tell anyone you can go all the way because the Spirit in you, he knows. Well, you can really go all the way or you turn back tonight and take only a portion of it. Or even a little portion of it, take it. So there's a law, the law of the identical office. As a man is so should he read. Regardless of what it appears to be, reads, you'll keep it. And you'll find in the end, everything is simply bearing witness to man and what man is doing. As Blake said, I went to the heathen the wild, to the thorns and the thistles of the waste. And they told me how they would be tired, and driven out, and compelled to chase. And you would not believe for one moment that Blake is telling us that the unwholesome suppressions of the normal natural urges of the animal bodies that we wear are the cause of the thorns and the thistles of the waste. That society is clamped down about all the normal, natural urges of the human animal body, and these are animal bodies that we wear. And by putting a flag upon the natural urges, then comes thorns and thistles of the waste. And what Baptist would believe that? He doesn't believe that for 1 second. And he thinks he's going to kill them by some insecticide or some other kind of thing. And go out and burn the rings, they'll all come back. As long as man walks the earth, who can impose these restrictions on growing healthy bodies and call them moral laws. There's nothing in this world but man. Because God is the only reality, and God is man. And man is God. So man is all the creation, and God is man, and exists in us, and we in him. The eternal body of man is the imagination, and that is God himself. So I tell you, whether you be a writer, as this young man writes, and undoubtedly writes about the world, to earn the kind of money he earns from his own confession, so he wanted an upgrade. He was spotted. But he lived with him for 2 years before he realized he was his own creation. But now what he did to rectify this problem of the story, you can do it. Being a writer, he took a great imaginative writer, anyone who could write, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. You certainly have an idea in that when you take Robert Louis Stevenson, and he can put his feet into the feet and the shoes of such an imaginative writer, and then right behind him, someone. It was Stevenson. He called in by a mood. You can tell by the mood that you wear, for you want to meet in this world. You wear moods, and they come. And he caught the mood. He wondered, what would the mood be like? What would it be like? And who? Ask him who? He's asking, what would Stevenson feel like? How did he feel after he finished what he considered a good script, a good story? And having caught that mood, then he said, I got back in my own shoes. And then I tried to match my own feeling to what I had imagined Stevenson must have felt. And so that he got them mated. And then to agree of touching anything of this earth, it shall be established for them in this world. If to agree, but he called the one with whom he wanted to agree in moods. And then, as though someone stood behind him and dictated the solution of every point that he brought the point of, it all came into his mind. You can never problem for you, for this man, a writer, to sit down and write it out. After the all solved in his mind. Then, taking his shovel and feeling very happy about what had just happened, he presently recalls what explains 6 years ago. And while he's contemplating it, it's like a sledgehammer on his head. Who would have thought he'd been walking around with his own creation for 2 years and didn't recognize him? And he didn't want to spring it on his wife. He thought, I'll test this first before I spring it on him. And so he described the character, leaving out very pertinent things like the link in the right leg and the use of the two words, unwanted, rejected. And leaving out things that were given the cue, he still could spot the character was Eddie. And so, that story you can take to heart tonight. What would it be like if you want money? Well, maybe mention someone who has noodles of it. What would it be like to him if he really wants money? Because many have it without any thought of money. But if someone really wants it, what would it be like if after he really went over in a big way? And if you try to match your feeling to that which you imagine he must have felt when he made what he considered the big killing. Match the feeling. And then just match him and see what happens. Just try it. What we're doing here is experimenting. Because this is the greatest problem in the world. As Foster said, the secret of imagining is the greatest of all problems, to the solution of which everyone should aspire. First of all, infinite power is there if you unravel it. Infinite wisdom and infinite delight. So if it contains all of these, as we can unravel the problem, then why not try it? So let us ask everyone to try it, and then share with us, and I in turn will share, as I did this night with this gentleman set up. Again, I repeat, I hope he keeps it up. And share it with me, that I in turn may share with you these properly lovely facets of this great diamond. For if he could put his imaginary feet into imaginary shoes and feel what the great Stevenson must have felt when he was satisfied with the story, and then take the shoes off on his own shoes, all in imagination, for he is taking his morning walk when all this is going through his mind. And people walking by will see a man walking by and possibly ignore him, not even have a second thought, or there might be none of us in his mind, but no one but the spirit of man would know. Who would know that by moment that Stevenson was walking by? But now he was wearing the shoes of Stevenson, Stevenson was there. To the point that where you sensed it, you would not see the man that was there and his wife would see. You would see Stevenson. You really would. Because all things that are now joined in one another's being mingled. And so they are outside in space, or outside in time. They're only as far away as you allow them to be. And your words can call them. Any being in this world. You can call anyone that's been gone for a number of centuries. Call it by feeling that you heed. sovereign, could really solve a certain problem for you, feel the darkness would break. Because they're not pushed out as the world would think. Say, in time, back to 1827, he certainly is not in any little grave in England. No one is there. And so they were only as far away as you let them be. So he went back and read the chapter on There Is No Fiction, and discovered he, the writer, and very humorously when he said in his letter, having written all my life, I have created such characters. I have showed you that I am in no hurry to meet them in the flesh. But it doesn't matter. The day will come, you move up by a spiral of motion when you least expect it. And without effort, work by and redeem every one of them. Every one will be forgiven for the plodding grave that I will create it either wittingly or unwittingly. And so, I ask you to join with me. Go to the text, and don't delay with your letters. Bring them to me. This as many as you possibly can, that I may encourage others to try it too. When you go home, read this chapter, the sixth chapter of the book of John. It really is the cessation chapter. They all departed, never to walk with him again. And only the few remain. And he turned, and they said, "Well, we know. You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed you. And we have come to know." It didn't come overnight. "We have come to know you are the Holy One of God." For the Holy One of God is God himself. You come to know it. But you're not pointing to a man. You found a creative presence within yourself. And although the world would try to make you feel that a creative presence is a power, speak of it as it. Don't personalize it. Oh, yes, you did. It's yourself you found. Not your person. So Christ is in you as the creative power in you. You are doing it, and you are a person. Therefore, Christ is a person. So is your Christ a person? You always talk about Christ as the creative power. He is not only person, he's the only person. He is the heavenly man. You're finding in yourself the heavenly man, the man that cannot die, the immortal you. And when you find him, don't let him go. Let everything else go, but don't let him go. So then Paul writes to Timothy. He said, "I know whom I have believed, not what. Whom?" And he's speaking now of Christ, and yet he defines Christ as the power and the wisdom of God. Having defined it as the power and wisdom, he personifies it, personifies it, because of himself, as we found. He found it in himself. You'll never find him on the outside. And so, to what extent this night you can go with the testimony of Christ Jesus, can you go all out and say that no man, no one, male or female, can come unto me unless my Father who sent me draws it. And I will raise him up at the last day. Leave that section alone. That's going to happen anyway. But to what extent can you accept that testimony? That no one can come unto me unless my Father who sent me draws him. And I and my Father are one because I am in my Father and my Father is in me. Can I go that far? And then go all out that not one being in this world could cross my path that I did not call. And those who come more intimately into my circle, they're really a thing that I've been dwelling upon. You start dwelling upon the so-called fragments of the world and traveling your mind's eye. You find yourself living in Russia. He lives right next door. Comes right in. And then you know how to get rid of him. You've been creating in your mind's eye a certain something, and he comes right into your world. You draw them as you draw them out of the panel. Now, let us go into the silence. Everything in Scripture from beginning to end is all about you. Not the garment that you're wearing, but you, the wearer of that garment. Everything from beginning to end is your real autobiography. Everything in Scripture from beginning to end is all about you. Not the garment that you're wearing, but you, the wearer of that garment. Everything from beginning to end is your real autobiography. Much of it you have not yet experienced, but it still is yours to be experienced, therefore truly an autobiography. At the moment you may read it as biography. Don't think it is of a never. It's all about you. The most insane revelation will prove itself true one day you experience it. It's all about you. When the child was brought forth and it was quickly caught up into heaven, you have that experience. The child will vanish from those who would try to destroy it. And the all the destructive powers of the world are still begotten by you. All in a state of dream, when man was sound asleep. So you were that being. I hope tonight you saw who Judas was. But some being who betrayed what the whole vast Christian world believes to be their Lord. No one could have betrayed a man unless he knew that man's secret. And no person knows a man's secret but the spirit of that man which is in him. So who is Judas? And the word Judas means the praise of Jehovah. Judas is praise. But man thinks the drama took place 2,000 years ago. It's taking place. All hail. So no man takes my life. I lay down myself. If no man takes my life, then what are you blaming a man for? I laid it down in every garment that moves upon the face of the earth. Unless I die, thou canst not live. But if I die, I shall rise again, and thou with me. And so he became man, that man would become God. And he did it voluntarily. You can imagine, well, that's Christ. That's the power of God. And it is personified, your power, because you're a person, therefore it is a person. Every evil act of the world needs a man as an agent, therefore it is a man. Every noble act needs a man as an agent, therefore it is man. So it's all personified. So the scripture personifies the powers. Yeah, that's right, they are powers. They are personified. Yes, sir. The coming of that is not distant future right from this platform, but with answer. Some claim that man is constantly robbed by looking back or looking forward. He is so concerned about what he did and what he is going to do, what he only encountered and what he hopes to encounter, and he omits the everlasting problem, which is I am. So Christ defines himself as I am the way. Assume it, because all things are possible